This podcast preview was originally recorded December 2018 at the home of Robert and Nena Thurman. Happy holidays, and hope to see you at Tibet House US and Menla in 2019. Tashi Dele.
So anyway, Merry Christmas, everybody. Happy Hanukkah. Happy Solar New Year, Roman New Year. And later, happy Tibetan New Year on February 5th. And so this is a Happy New Year and Happy Christmas time. Now, I read a very interesting editorial in the New York Times this last Sunday, because it's only December 5th now, we're looking forward. December 4th, actually, today. And there was a very nice Jewish writer writing about how he was embarrassed about Hanukkah, even though today I think it's the third day of Hanukkah. And my dear friend Paul was lighting third candle, I think, today in the menorah. And I love the menorah tradition. But anyway, he was saying he doesn't like Hanukkah because Hanukkah celebrates the Maccabees, who were kind of like fundamentalist Jews, you know, going against the Hellenized Jews, who are a little more relaxed and pluralistic and not so rigid, you know, about their belief system. And he considers himself a Hellenized Jew, although Americanized, you know, this guy who was writing. So he's unhappy to celebrate the triumph of the fundamentalists over the more pluralistic, relaxed ones. He wrote. I didn't know all that. I thought it was quite fascinating. I'm learning so many things in my old age, like about how the Hasidics think the earth is sacred and the earth is made of God and it's not nothing. And therefore they're more environmentally and they're more joyful on earth than more Orthodox people. You know, I think that's really cute. I only learned that recently too. Somebody even questioned it, oh, that can't be so, you know, they were saying from whatever they knew about Hasidics, but I think it is so. So anyway, the source I read was impeccable, I believe. And so I thought that's very cute. The Tibetans, we have our own candle festival, which always comes around this solstice time also, which is a candle lighting for Lama Tsongkhapa, who in 1419, 599 years ago, left his coarse body, as they would say, because he was a yogi who understood life and death and death and life. And so he left a coarse body consciously at the age of 62, a relatively short lifespan in the high altitude Tibet. And he then appeared in a subtle body form, in a youthful subtle body form, in consort with a female partner, yogic partner, showing the male-female union type of Buddhahood, of esoteric teaching, in a glorious, radiant vision. All of his attending disciples saw that, they report, you know, in the biographies. And so in honor of that wonderful thing, and he could have done that if he had resigned as a monk in 1398, when he attained a very high level of enlightenment, he could have done that bodily, what they would think of as a bodily enlightenment as well. But he didn't, because he wanted to keep the monk's vow, not having the partner, you know, until to set an example for the other Tibetans, which was very self-restrained and wonderful of him. For 21 years, he did that. So we have another candlelighting thing. So then, in this article, this great writer, I'm sorry I can't remember his name, he was saying how he does Hanukkah to fend off his daughter, 5-year-old or something, who was wanting Santa. And he couldn't provide Santa, you know, because he was thinking as Jewish, because he's Jewish, that Santa is some sort of Christmas thing. But you know, that's totally not correct, actually. He didn't get into that, but I know that. Santa is really a pagan thing, you know, neither Jewish nor Christian, but it's basically the idea of the return of fertility, prosperity, the anticipation eventually of spring by reaching the shortest day in the Northern Hemisphere and then beginning to have longer days, and the rising of the light, you know, the sort of death of the light and the rebirth of the light. And that's why Christmas is on that, around that time, always in the solar calendar. And in the lunar calendar, Tsongkhapa's thing, 25th day of the 10th lunar month is usually around the time of the solstice. And so Hanukkah fits with that time. But then I was wondering, and then I wanted to say to you, why is it that he can't have Santa? Now, I've been in the same position, being a Buddhist, sort of half-baked Buddhist that I am, in that our kids, they wanted Santa. Where's Santa? Where's Christmas, you know? And also everybody likes baby Jesus, whether you're Christian or not, and whether he's the Messiah. If you don't think he's the Messiah, if you're Jewish, he's just a prophet or he's a nice rabbi. And that, you should just see him as a nice rabbi and not get all upset about it. And celebrate his birth. He did a great job, you know. He showed that he couldn't be killed by a bunch of crappy Romans. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. But they didn't do that. So the point is, why doesn't he let his daughter have a Santa, have a Jewish Santa? Who cares? In the Buddhists, we have someone called Vaishravana, who is considered the guardian king of the north, a deity in India, but they could think of it as an angel in one of the monotheistic traditions without any sweat. And he's associated with wealth and gifts and presents and generosity. He lives in a giant jewel palace, and he has horsemen who distribute jewels all over the place. He doesn't have reindeer, but he's kind of like a Vaishravana figure for Buddhists in Japan and China and Korea and Tibet and in India in the ancient time. And so that's like Santa. So then what we used to do is we used to talk about the Tibetan New Year, where the Buddha made miracles for 2 weeks at the Lunar New Year to sort of show his miraculous abilities, which normally he hid. You know, and it's against the rules in the Buddhist monk order or mendicant order to show off if you have supernormal powers. I never say supernatural, supernormal. But he did do that this 1-2 week period toward the end of his life to just kind of leave a hint to the people and to posterity that if you attain full and perfect enlightenment, you really can shape the material world, which you wouldn't do for your own pleasure because you have total pleasure just to start with. If you're enlightened, fully enlightened, but Buddha, you're made of pleasure. You realize that all beings and all life is made of pleasure, of joy, of bliss, you know. So you don't need any more. But you might want to rearrange things for the benefit of those who are suffering, to get them to open up to their true deeper nature, where they'll be more gentle and more happy and more fulfilled, you know, which is a great teacher, a great prophet. That's what they're all trying to do. God is trying to do that too, in all of those monotheistic ideas, you know. So, point is, that's what the Tibetans celebrate, sort of that magical thing, and they make gifts, and they do, you know, in the Losar. So all of it all has to do with a kind of ancient, cyclical, calendrical celebration of death and rebirth, right? Because the sun dies and gets to its shortest day in the Northern Hemisphere on December 21st or 2nd, and then it starts to grow again, you know, up to the summer solstice, where it's the night is pretty much suppressed, you know. And then when you're near the poles, you have the all day, the summer night, the midsummer night, and then you have the all dark winter, you know, when you get nearer the pole. And you have the opposite time of year in the southern hemisphere, right? So that's what it's all about. It's not some sort of religious sectarian thing in any case. And of course, if you're Jewish, you don't celebrate Jesus as the Messiah. And you shouldn't, because you don't believe that he is. You see him as a Messiah, maybe, or a prophet. The Muslims see him as a great prophet within the line from all the way back to Moses. And they accept him as that, but not the way the Christians do. But still, they still like him. And there's a lot. I have Jewish colleagues, academics, and they write books like Rabbi Jesus, you know. And Rabbi Hillel, for example, I believe was in the first century of the Common Era, first CE century, and he taught just like Jesus about altruism and self-sacrifice, self-transcendence, and all this sort of thing. And Judaism is about that anyway. So, you know, I wish that guy, I'd like to write him an op-ed myself, that to be... I really like the New York Times nowadays. You know, Michelle Alexander of Mass Incarceration, the new Jim Crow book, Fame, wonderful lady. I'd like to get her on my podcast. But by the way, I wish she would join me. I admire her so much. I'd like to talk to her about her op-ed, where she was so frustrated with the elite of our country that they won't really share, they won't let people out of jail who are unjustly put there, they won't do climate change to fix the planet. You know, they're just grubbing ahead, grabbing whatever they can grab. And they think that being in politics and being a political leader means you can rip people off legally, rather than it means that you're supposed to serve people and do public service, which is what it's supposed to mean. And she was so frustrated that she said, I wonder if they would behave better if they felt they were going to be reborn in the same environment, instead of this idea that I'm going to live it up to the hilt and suck whatever I can out of it all and then die and be nothing, but I've had like a wild ride in between, which is a kind of psycho behavior of the elite of our culture, which I totally agree with her. So, and she writes, what if there was reincarnation? Although she says she doesn't think so. But in case there was, wouldn't it be better? She's kind of saying, you know, if people knew that, you know. Well, the Buddhist ethical and biological theory of karma, as I've told you all here many times, they definitely say we are going to be back here or in some environment, and the environment is going to give us feedback of how what we've dished out into it, and therefore there's long-term consequence of what you do. And so much so, and I make it such an emphasis of that, that one of my editors once said, my book called Infinite Life, which is a book I really like, that I shouldn't call it Infinite Life, I should call it Infinite Consequences. So at the time I said, well, she could leave that title to John Ashcroft, or Jeffrey Sessions, I could say nowadays, and until recently. And I was not emphasizing that, I was emphasizing Infinite Life. But Infinite Life means you have infinite consequences of what you do right now in this moment. So it means that this moment connects to eternity. So that gives you even more incentive to make this moment awesome. Because you definitely want awesome eternity. If you're stuck here for eternity, you don't want to suffer. You don't want to make others suffer because they'll end up making you suffer. And also it's not nice for them to suffer. If you're happy, you don't need other people suffering around you. No way. So anyway, so happy Christmas, Hanukkah, New Year, Losar, Gandengamche, whatever kind of celebration you're doing about the death and the rebirth of the light, showing that light cannot be destroyed. That's what this is all about. So every kid can have a Santa, candy cane, Hanukkah, presents for 8 days, whatever they like they can have, you know, because the poor things are facing a long life of struggle. And that they have some great Christmases type of things, Hanukkah type of things, Losar type of things, is very important for them, to encourage them to face it, you know. And in fact, in the Buddhist tradition, we can encourage them, they can be truly blissful permanently and use the human life to achieve a really steady and reliable trajectory toward that. And they can do that without having to be a religiously nominal Buddhist, by developing their mind, their heart, their body, their love, their compassion, their learning, their insight into the nature of reality. They can find out that reality makes that impossible for them, realistically. And that you can find out, you can interpret God as giving you that if you're a monotheist. You can make a determination of that God, and you can change the theologies from horrible, sadistic ones that make God always deny you satisfaction and elevate cruelty, you know, demonstrate cruelty, which you then elevate in a culture. These are cruel, bad, you know, misunderstandings of monotheism, even, I would say, I would argue. So people can keep their religious traditions and just interpret them in such a way as to be more realistic and more scientific. And in doing so, then we will get away from any of these like authoritarian, militaristic, violent cultures that make people miserable. that encourage cruelty and violence and make them unhappy. So this is what we are celebrating. The miracle of this time is the time that the good guys, the gentle people, the loving people are more powerful than the cruel, bad, violent, nasty guys and or girls. And so that's what we celebrate. And we renew our hope and our encouragement for that enterprise in whatever cultural and religious terms we put it. You know, pluralism doesn't mean you allow all negative views of some other tradition. Like, for example, if somebody interpreted Christianity as meaning they should go out and kill every non-Christian, that is not acceptable under religious pluralism because it's so unpluralistic and it's actually lethal and dangerous. Similarly, if they interpreted Islam or Buddhism or Hinduism or Confucianism or communism like that, that anybody who does, or capitalism, anybody who doesn't share their ideology or religious worldview should be worse than human and therefore subject to being put to death and treated cruelly and oppressed. This is just totally wrong. And that's not a matter of, that's not allowing, and that is a question of not allowing insane people to run around hurting themselves and others. It's not a question of not being religiously pluralistic. You know, when people overinterpret pluralism in the wrong way as to think that whatever somebody else claims is religion, they can then get away with. Like a big con job organization like Scientology, for example. Oh yeah, we're a religion, so we don't pay taxes and you can't tell us what we can do. Well, they're conning people out of their money. And they're pretending that holding these electric things, they're getting all enlightened, which is all nonsense. Although as a community, any community can have some benefits to its members. So it's not all black and white, or white and black. But that's really an important thing to remember. So we're celebrating the rebirth of joy, the rebirth of love, gentleness, sweetness, compassion. That's what we're celebrating at this holiday time. And that's why we call it a holy day. Okay? And everyone can do it in their own way, and we can really have a great time doing it. So that's what I'm wishing you here to do. Now, what we do at our Menla, our Medicine Master Buddha Mountain retreat, is we do this at Solar New Year. And we have a four-day thing, and my beloved colleague, Sharon Salzberg, one of the great meditation if not the greatest meditation teacher of her generation and our generation. Maybe she's younger than me. Maybe it's not quite my generation. Maybe I'm too old. I don't know. But she's just the greatest. And she always comes very graciously to Menla. And we teach together with a kind of combined sort of Buddhist level, but again, in the way we do at Menla, where it's not religious, you don't have to be Buddhist at all. It's a Buddhist. We have Buddhism, not Buddhism there. And we have a wonderful time rekindling hope for the new year, which is what we do then at the new year as well, even though we're already 8-9 days into the growing of the light, past the death of the light on the 21st of December. So that's really important. And then I also want to invite everybody to our great Nguyen Lem concert in February 5th, this coming 2019 year of the pig, year of the earth pig. And I want everyone to come because we have to pray for His Holiness the Dalai Lama, who will be 84, and therefore it's in his own pig year. He was born in the pig year 1935, and that's supposed to, when you're in your own year, every 12 years, you have to be very careful not to run into any obstacles. And so if someone you love is in their obstacle year, as the Tibetans call it, when their own birth year comes up, they have to do something special, you do special things for them, you pray for them, you try to like take away obstacles from them on yourself or whatever, however you do it. We have to think about that, about the wonderful being, the Dalai Lama, on this New Year's on February 5th. And what we did there was that Dzongpa in 1409 established this as a tradition in Lhasa, Tibet, capital of Tibet, where for 2 weeks, everybody goes on vacation. No businesses were functioning, nothing except basic, you know, life services. And the spiritual people take over the management of the, they become sheriff, you know, for a fortnight from the new moon to the full moon of the first lunar month. And they celebrate the 2 weeks of the miracles that Shakyamuni Buddha did in the new year in India, in the Lunar New Year, where he did things like, and this is the Christmas tree, that's right, that's how I got this. And this is the Christmas tree. So one of the first miracles he did, when some king offered him a fruit or some meal, he ate it, and then he was given a toothpick, as a Indian tradition, I guess, after a meal, you give the visitor a toothpick. And he used it to clean his teeth. But then he took the toothpick and he planted it in the ground. He chucked it in the ground like that. And it suddenly sprouted into a giant tree with growing, instead of fruits, jewels. Like a jeweled, like with Christmas ornaments tree, like a jeweled Christmas tree. So this is what we used in my family to simulate Christmas for our daughters, although we were neither going to a church nor a synagogue or anything like that. And even we didn't even probably have a proper Buddhist temple because we lived in a regular town, you know, in America. And so that was the Christmas tree. And then this tree had an amazing property, which was it then radiated light to the thousands of people assembled in this particular set of miracle contests that the Buddha was in these 2 weeks. And the light came out of the jewels hanging on the jewel Christmas tree, jewel Buddha tree, toothpick tree, magical tree. And then when the light was seen by the people, they temporarily became clairvoyant. And they became also aware that their own thoughts became readable by others around them. So everybody was reading everybody else's mind, in other words, by the blessing of this light. And therefore, everybody became extremely mindful about what they were thinking. Because if you had a negative thought about someone, neighbor, or that guy, something like that, then it became audible to the other people and they would look at you. So then you were really trying to control and think only positive thoughts. And then when they were in that mindful focus, the Buddha gave a 2 or 3 hour teaching to them about how to purify your mind. You know? So his miracle always had a kind of output, like a piece of performance art or something the Buddha did in these stories. I mean, you don't have to even believe the stories if you don't need to, if you're into materialism and you think no one can do miracles. It's just called it a literary miracle. But the point is a piece of performance art, getting the people receptive to then listen to a teaching. And the teaching is in order to get them to deepen their understanding of reality themselves, what they are. That they're actually happier than they think they are. And they have more blessings than they know they have. That's what a teacher is trying to do. Not trying to make them start, enter some fantasy world, unrealistic fantasy world somewhere else, based on some authority. It's trying to actually help them open their critical mind and open their deeper, more penetrating insight so they can be more aware of what reality is. In fact, because why does Buddha want them to do that? Because Buddha discovered that reality is great. Reality has everything we need in it already, if we knew how to access it, if we understood that. What we don't, by not understanding that, we don't look for it. We look elsewhere, where we look in all the wrong, looking for love in all the wrong places. As somebody said, I forgot who did, Eddie Murphy maybe. Okay, so that's it. That's my New Year's greeting. And I'm promoting Menla's weekend from the 27th, I think, to January 1st, December 27th, January 1st. Wonderful time we're going to have there. Just join up. We already have lots of people, but I think there's more room. And then second, the concert, which usually does really well, sells out Carnegie Hall. People just come for the blessing and the music. And there we celebrate the possibility of the miraculous. And nowadays we're all having a hard time. And by the way, that's just one other kind of realistic thing. I'm very upset with Wisconsin and the awful Scott Walker, who just got kicked out as governor. But they unfortunately, but probably because of vote suppression and cheating by the Republicans in charge up until the election, The legislatures of Wisconsin is still in Republican hands, and so what they're doing is like what they did in North Carolina when Roy Cooper won the Democratic governorship after a long monopoly by Republicans, is they try to pass all kinds of crazy laws preventing the new governor from fixing any of the mess they had made of the state's education system and other things, and unions and working men and women, a total mess. People get in government, that kind of people get in government, and then they think this, now I can rob everybody legally. Before I just did it as a businessman or some other kind of shady person, as a ruthless businessman, but now I can rob them as a ruler or governor. I can take bribes, I can channel money toward companies that are paying me off in some other way, even if I don't openly take bribes or whatever. You know, they just think that government service means serving yourself at the expense of the people, which is not what government service is. Government service is you serve the people. You know, you have noblesse oblige. You adopt that element of kingship, good side. You have a sense of noblesse oblige toward the people. And you do things for them, and you sacrifice yourself, actually. That's what kingship, that's what being a leader is about. Not about robbing people and suborning them. Terrible, really. So everyone should be alert to any of these places that were turned around, away from the nasty, fear-mongering bunch of self-centered people, to people who would have some vision, at least, of trying to be sensible. And yet they're trying to cripple them ahead of time in the lame duck sessions everywhere. So people should be aware of that and be up against it. Don't think just because you voted that it's over. You go up and like make a protest and write a letter and call them on the phone and don't allow this. And this is a great way of keeping your joy up in the holiday. You know, there's a wonderful book by Alice Walker, another of my heroes, called The Secret of Joy. And she writes in the big final punchline of that really horrifying but beautiful novel, with which I still dream of making a movie one day. And that is possessing the secret of joy. What is the secret of joy? It is resistance. That's what it is. In other words, if you're getting suppressed, you're not going to be joyful. But if you resist, even if you're not right away successful, then you find your joy again. Because you come back to life, you know, and life is joy, you know. So it's joyful. It's not a strain or horrible to do that. It might be a little scary if you're timid to speak truth to power, but actually it brings joy is what it does. And that we should know, okay? So by being happy, you're resisting. That's a key thing. Being happy, you're resisting. You know, I was just reading a beautiful thing in the recent New Yorker, which published some old articles from past decades, which are so beautiful. What a wonderful institution that New Yorker is. And what they did was, James Baldwin, I read an essay of his, and what a powerful thing, the way he understood it, and what he understood, the cruelty of white people to black people, the way he expressed it, was deeply touching and moving, you know. And we all should read more of his works, really. And But the great thing that he's noticed was, which in a way shows his compassion as a person and as a writer, that the cruelty by the white people on the black people, which was even worse then as now, but it still goes on, really, and so it's still worse in a way, you could say. It's never unworse until it's totally not worse. You don't have degrees of worse, really. But the point is that they do that because they're unhappy. Because they feel insufficient, they feel cramped, so that makes people cruel when they're unhappy. And he recognized that. So in a way, that was a look of compassion he's giving, even though he's protesting and he's being honest and rigorous. But his protest is from compassion. It's a joyful resistance. That seeing the unhappiness in the oppressor and realizing that's the source of the oppression. It's via ideology, via habit, via upbringing, via what Wilhelm Reich called the emotional plague of the self-suppressed person who then can only get a thrill by suppressing some other people. So therefore, they won't be able to stop the oppressing the other people until somehow they have mercy on themselves, which is more a little more complicated, but that's the essence of it, actually. So this, you can learn all about this. Just come join us at Menla, or join your own teacher somewhere, or go see your rabbi, go see your minister, if they're the type who are not uptight, you know. And have a great 2019, a great year of the Earth Pig, okay? And I'll talk to you again soon. All the best.
This video was brought to you in part through the generous support of the Tibet House U.S. membership community and listeners like you. To learn more about the benefits of Tibet House membership, including trips with Robert Thurman, please visit tibethouse.us.